Open your Bibles to 1 Samuel. 1 Samuel. We start a new study on Wednesday night. We're going to look at the life of Samuel rather than actually the books. We're going to cover the life. And the reason for that is kind of interesting. Samuel has two books named after him. But he's no longer in either of these books after chapter 24. At the end of chapter 4, he's dead, and we have his funeral in the 25th chapter, verse 1. And it wasn't much of an obituary either. I mean, you would really have to hunt for this thing, which is kind of an interesting thing because this guy had an enormous ministry. But you got two books named after him, and he's probably the least in the books. When you actually study 1 Samuel and 2 Samuel, you're going to find that the three men dominate the book. Samuel, Saul, and David. And by the time you get to 2 Samuel, the whole book's about David. It's kind of interesting. But I'll tell you what is really interesting about Samuel is the first three chapters, and we're going to look at the first three chapters very closely, and then we're going to start looking at his life and ministry. Samuel's life and everything is just interesting, at least to me. Now, you'll notice that today I've gone to Samuel, the third chapter, to introduce the book. So I want you to go to chapter 3 with me, because in chapter 3, something really interesting happened, because actually Samuel's mother, Hannah, had it in her mind that he should follow in his father Elkanah's footsteps and be because he was of the tribe of Levi. And his specific family in the tribe of Levi were singers in the tabernacle. They were the tabernacle singers. And so she wanted him to follow in his father Elkanah's footsteps. And so his life gets really interesting when she sends him to boarding school with Eli, the high priest. She sent him to boarding school to be developed in that field. And in the third chapter, as a young guy working in the temple in the boarding school of the priest under the high priest Eli, come on in, girls. We're just waiting on you. Yeah, just waiting on you. The Lord, in the third chapter, while he's still in, now he's in senior level, he's about to graduate and, you know, do that kind of thing. The Lord speaks to him, and audibly, and it's quite an event. His calling away from priesthood and into prophecy, to be a prophet, is really amazing. So I wanted to start there because his life is changed in the middle of the stream by God himself. And he doesn't follow his earthly father's ministry, he followed his heavenly father's ministry, and he had quite a ministry. Well, in the third chapter of Samuel, 1 Samuel, third chapter, looking at verses 19 and 20, if I can get back to it, third chapter, 19, 20, the Lord has spoke to him three times audibly. And he has gone and he has discussed these what he's heard. The Lord would speak to him audibly, and he thought Eli was calling him. So he'd run to Eli. And Eli said, I didn't call you. Go back to bed and go to sleep. And then a little later, he'd be back. So he did that. And then it dawns on Eli, cha-ching, it must be the Lord. And so he said, the next time, give me that information. Bring it to me and I'll tell you what's going on. And so he did. And this is pretty amazing. And he realized that God had, because he gave a prophecy about Eli. He didn't want to tell him because he didn't know how he would take it. And the prophecy was not good. He told him, this ain't going to be good for you. And so he didn't want to tell Eli, right? You don't want to give your boss bad news. Affect his grades and graduation probably. But anyhow, and so in verse 19 and 20, 21, Samuel grew and the Lord was with him and let none of his words fail. This is looking way ahead of the, listen, God foresees your life. You can see it scripturally. You can walk it out scripturally. You know, it talked about Abraham the other night, foreseeing the Gentiles. So he's in the midst of his call, and God lays out where this is going to take him. And so we have a footnote here about his life. It says, and Samuel grew, and the Lord was with him. And he's talking spiritually now, not just. He's kind of like talking here like Luke 2, 42 and 52, or however that was, you know, how Jesus grew in stature and in the word and all that business. This is, Samuel grew, and the Lord was with him, and let none of the words fail him. This is a prophetic look at his life. And all Israel from Dan to Beersheba knew that that's the whole land of Israel. If you look at a map, you're from the top to the bottom. Israel from Dan even to Beersheba knew that Samuel was confirmed as a prophet of the Lord. And the Lord appeared again at Shiloh. That's where the tabernacle was. Because the Lord revealed himself to Samuel at Shiloh by the word of the Lord. That's where Samuel was boarded. He went to boarding school there under the high priest. So he's just... He's just an interesting prophet, and I'm going to show you much about him today as we introduce our subject of the life of Samuel. I really believe he's the prophet for us for 2017. I think the things we'll learn from him will be very helpful to us in our ministry in 2017. Let me have a word of prayer with you, and then I'll show you a few things about the life of Samuel. I think it'll be important. I give you, as a believer, you know, your cell phones are off. That's first. And then the second is that you're spiritually prepared to the Word of God so that it can be transferred out of the Scriptures and into your soul so that you can get spiritual truth, which is absolute because it comes from God. And to do that, you have to be spiritual. The difference between carnal and spiritual is carnal, you know, you've committed a sin. The Holy Spirit is grieved and quenched. And confession of sin is going to bring that back. He hasn't left you. He's still in your body, and your body is the temple of God. That hasn't changed a bit positionally because of grace salvation. But you need to be spiritual because you can't study the Bible carnal. So mental attitude, sins of the tongue, overt sin should be considered. This would be true for you who are watching with us and live streaming with us off the internet. You need to do this. You need to shut down distractions, the television or whatever, get into a different place so you can focus. Let the Lord speak to your heart through the Word of God. 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, maybe you will, maybe you won't, but if you don't, you won't. You might as well just close your Bible and watch whatever you intend to watch tonight, because you won't get it from the Word. But if you want to study the Bible and get spiritual truth and confess your sins, because he's faithful and just to forgive you and cleanse you, this will restore spirituality to your life, and spirituality is how you study 1 Corinthians 3. Father, we're so thankful tonight for these who have come our way, both by automobile and by internet. And we know the Lord has brought us together. I mean, who else could ever do this? I mean, some 15 different nations tap into us and listen to us. How's that possible? All over Russia, all over places that we've never visited other than this way. People we've never met other than this way. And this way appears to be an okay way at this present time. And I pray today as we look at the life of Samuel over the next many weeks that we will gain much information about our life and our calling into the ministry. The things that God has in store for us, no matter what vocation we have, we're in ministry. I pray we would see that. And we're in full-time Christian service based on our volition. We're ambassadors and we're priests, and there are a lot of things that we are called to be in full-time Christian service. So we pray for that in Jesus' name. Amen. First thing I want you to do, see, I left you space on the bottom of your paper. Good to have you home. When do you go back to school?
Next Wednesday.
Next Wednesday. Boy, you guys really have some time off, don't you? You must really be tough on teachers that give you that much time off. Takes that much healing. Well, anyhow, on the bottom of the paper, I want you to write down a few things about the book. Chapter-wise, I got 8 things I want you to write down that we can look. For example, chapter 1 is about his birth. He has a unique birth. Not as unique as Jesus Christ, of course, but he does have a unique birth. And how famous is the story of Hannah and her prayer? And in fact, the name Samuel means God heard and answered prayer. I mean, that E-L on the end of that name, the first part of the name is hearing, and the last part of it is God. God heard my prayer and answered. It's the name Samuel. The E-L on the end is a word for God. Well, anyhow, so chapter 1 is about the birth. It's an amazing birth. Chapter 2 is a boarding school. She sends him to boarding school as a toddler. She sent him to boarding school as a toddler. And he was gone. Now, he made his residence in the hometown of Ramah. That's where he stayed. And that was good for Mama. But virtually, when he got through boarding school, God had already called him, sent him to missions. I mean, he was on the run. But he did base in the hometown. Came from a pretty large family. His mother started out barren, and then, boy, she got to become fruitful myrtle. That so often happens, doesn't it? Unless Mama shuts it down. Chapter 3 is his amazing call to be a prophet. He was going to, listen, he was ready to become the singing priest. I mean, he was ready. He'd gone through school. Got his, you know, he was ready to graduate. God called him. He said, yeah, I want you. Of course I want you in the prime of your life. Yeah. And it's an amazing calling. That's chapter 3. Chapters 4 through 7, point number 4, chapters 4 through 7, he has a double calling. They're at war. Israel is at war, and God calls him to be the last judge as well as a prophet. Samuel is the 13th judge and closes out. Samuel is so unique. God used him to close down judgeship and open up monarchy. He used this man to be the transitional guy between two different forms of government. And this guy did an amazing job. I mean, he's worth the study in that alone. Amazing job. And so we'll look at that. Number five, in chapter 8, he becomes a prophet to a new form of government called a theocracy monarchy. A theocracy monarchy. A monarchy. There's kings now. And God wants those kings to understand he rules them, that he reigns over them. So we call it a theocracy monarchy. It was a theocracy judgeship. Now it's a theocracy monarchy. And this guy's responsible as the last judge to make this transition. Chapter 8 is this an enormous chapter. And then chapters 9 through 15, this is number 6 on my paper. Chapters 9 through 15, he becomes a prophet to King Saul. He's a national prophet to the first King Saul. That didn't go well for Saul. I mean, it seemed like every time he walked into his office, he brought him bad news. But that's because of Saul's volition, wasn't it? He just didn't want to pay attention to God. And, you know, and the interesting thing about Saul, he looked, I mean, he was Hollywood look. I mean, he was, I mean, if you had to pick a guy out and give him a script and put him on the screen to be the first king of Israel, you'd have picked Saul, handsome, personable, full of, and what he was full of finally came out, and he got in a whole lot of trouble with God, okay? In chapter 16 through 24, he's the national prophet to King David. And boy, in that section, almost all your stories about young David come out of that section, don't they? He fights the bears and the lions and Goliath, and then gets in trouble with Saul, and Saul, you know, won't surrender himself like the Lord told him to, and Samuel keeps telling him. And then in he dies, and we have only one verse, one small verse, which is chapter 25, verse 1, which is his obituary. This wonderful man. And there's a real story for all of us in the ministry. I mean, it's all about how God views you and how it's going to be in the next life where your rewards come. The world may never honor you, may never give you accolades, may never give you any script. Don't matter how big, but that's not important. That should not be important to you in the ministry. Being faithful unto God is what's important. And this guy was that was that kind of guy. And he had some bulls in the china shop to have to deal with, both with Saul and David. But David was his bright light. I mean, he had Saul, and then he had David, and David was like, whoa. Oh, thank you, God, for David. Well, and then the eighth thing is interesting, because he's dead at chapter 24, obituary in chapter 25, verse 1. And he shows up again in chapter 28. Now, he's dead. And chapter 28 is one of the most interesting stories in the Bible. And you're going to love it. Because he gives a prophecy after he was dead to King Saul. And he tells him, you never listened to me. You never listened to the word of God. And everything I told you before still holds true to you. I mean, every time he showed up, he gave bad news to Saul. Why would Saul want him to show up again? But that's a wonderful story. That's a good story. And that's pretty much what you're going to find in this man. But he's just, while there's not a lot said about him, not even in the Bible, compared, you know. I mean, I don't remember. I think you got like 38, 31 chapters maybe in 1 Samuel. Is there like 31? And then like in 2 Samuel, you got like 25. How much is that? I know. That's a lot of chapters, ain't it? Yeah, that's a lot of chapters. And he's dead at 24. And yet he's got two books. God gave him two books. God, yeah, putting his name on two books. And he's only at the first chapter, 24. He's dead. Well, he shows up again because Saul is not eating a fruitcake, and he shows up back in 28. But, which is a whole interesting story in itself. You know, Samuel, when I read the book, started paying attention to his life and if I wanted to teach it or not, I discovered something about Samuel. And I thought about this. Samuel, like each of us, his life was divided in his ages of his book, what I would say the Christian way of life. There were stages. And listen to this. And each one of these stages in your life is very important to where God wants to take you. Listen to these stages and see if that's true in your life. Some of us have a whole lot more trauma in it than others. But there was a life before you were saved. There's a life after you're saved as a baby believer. You still have a lot of struggles and a lot of dealing with old stuff and things. There's a life after being a baby as you begin to advance in spiritual growth. And that's kind of an exciting time. You're just learning so much. And other people don't know what you know, and you get to share it. It's just exciting to do that. Then there's this final stage, and you see all of this in the life of Samuel. You see all these stages in the life of Samuel. There is the what I call the now life, where when you reach spiritual maturity, God puts you into just enormous ministry. Now, I don't mean enormous in a lot of stuff where, you know, you conquer five nations or something. Like, you know, I'm not talking about something like a Caesar of Rome. But I'm talking about the things that God has assigned you, you max them out. And that's the power of reaching spiritual maturity and maintaining it, because it is in that little section. And listen, that little section of your life could be a week, it could be a month, it could be a few years, but whatever it is, it's full of powerful things from God. You're going to see it in Samuel's life. And listen, his influence over guys who would listen to the Word of God that he taught. Now, Samuel wouldn't listen to him, and so, you know, he was always nosediving. I mean, his plane was always being shot out of the sky, bailing out in water. But David, let me tell you, when he was a man after God's heart, he was a man after Samuel's too, because he listened to the word Samuel taught him. Samuel was his pastor teacher, and he was a good one. So I just find it interesting when I studied his life. I went, well, geez, you know, I mean, he had this enormous career because God handpicked him. And that's true with all of us. Every one of us in here, God handpicked us in the sense of our salvation and is grooming us for the now life in Christ. Grooming us. I'm so happy that I still realize that he's grooming me. I guess it'll go all the way through the end. Man, I don't know of any other way. I ain't retiring. Gonna get me with my boots on. Now, the final stage of these stages of growth, these stages of a person's life, this final stage of the now life is why two books of the Bible are named after Samuel. He's not the key guy in them. So why would God do that? Because of his now life, the impact of his now life with God. He reached that stage where he wasn't looking to the right or the left. He stayed focused. His eyes stayed on Christ, and he's driving it all the way to the end. He's not looking back. I'm not looking back. I'm not dragging it. I ain't got a dead corpse hanging on me, freed because of Jesus Christ, and I'm not looking back. I'm not going to look back and say, oh, woe is me if I hadn't. I'm looking at what God has put before me. You just drive on till the end. Horton, hoo-ah. I'm good there, right? His life is going to be finished after chapter 25, actually 24. His life is going to be changed. He's over at 24. We have an obituary in verse 1 of chapter 25. Well, I put down 31 chapters, 24. I didn't realize that. I spoil you guys. But you're... Now, this is... God is in grace. That's how generous God is in grace. In Bible, he takes a back seat. Other believers that Paul and David. And listen, he was okay with that because God, that's what God assigned him to be the pastor of these guys. To be a prophet and tell them the truth. Look them right in the eye and tell them the truth, no matter how it affected them, nor how it affected you. You can see hesitates to give it to Eli. And Eli has to pull it out of it and said, "You boy, you better tell me right now what God told you." And he said, He said, "Boy, I said, you better tell me, and you better tell me right now." You know, when Mama says that, you tell her. Well, you do when God does it too. Eli, he said, "Spit it out. I can handle it." Oh boy, did he spit it out. "Go make your will out." That's basically what he told them. "Go make your will out, Bubba." Well, anyhow, I found it interesting because of Mark 9, 33 through 37, where 5, he makes this statement. Now, the whole part, you go back and you study all of it, but I'm going to give you the gist of it. I'm going to give the cliff notes. "If anyone wants to be first, he shall be last of all and servant of all." You see, what he's teaching is if you want to be a great leader, you've got to learn to be a good follower. You'd never be a good leader if you're not a good follower. And see, it's hard to get people to understand that. But to be a minister, that's how this thing works. Now, that's not the way it works in the world, but it's the way it works in the plan of God. The type of follower, what type of follower you are will influence what type of leader you will be. You want to be a leader that has spiritual impact. You've got to be able to learn that principle. Jesus said it again in Matthew 11:11 when he said about John the Baptist. Listen to what he said about John. He said, "Truly I say to you, among those born of women..." Now, there's been a whole lot in the kingdom born of women that become really giants for God. We got a whole Old Testament full of them. We got Hebrews 11 full of them. And he says, "Truly I say to you, among those born of women, there has not arisen anyone greater than John the Baptist." I'm going like, holy catfish. You know why? Because John was able to stay focused on his mission. It wasn't that he had greater in the sight of God what had been assigned to him. What had been assigned to him, he maxed it out. And Jesus salutes him. His job was to be a heralder of the coming of the Messiah. And he did it, and he saluted him. That's what this verse means. Listen, and then listen, he gives everybody a word here. He says, "Yet the one who is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he." In other words, he's saying, listen, there's not one person in here that can't reach that status if when God gives you an assignment, you take it and you complete it. And every time he gives you one, you take and complete it. You always finish the mission. You always complete it. And you do it until there is no more assignments given to you. See, I love that verse because I'm one of those guys. And I have learned. Take the assignment that God gives you and drive it. Don't listen to people to tell you ought to do this, you ought to do that. You do what I tell you to do. You carry it to the mission. You take it to the house. You take it to the barn, as I used to say where I live. Now, do you wonder, like I did, if Samuel's in the great book of Hebrews 11? I mean, did he make the book? And the answer is yes. I looked it up. I didn't have to guess. I went to Hebrews 11 chapter and read verse 32, and I found something very interesting. That's why it pays to read the Bible, stop and have prayer with the Spirit, stop and have prayer with the Lord, and let the Spirit show you things that you would have never seen had you not stopped to pray. So when I asked that question, I went to Hebrews, I went to chapter 11:32, and I said, there he is, Father, but this seems strange to me, so tell me, what's going on here? And I'm going to tell you what I learned. And what more shall I say? For time will fail me if I tell of Gideon. I don't have enough time to tell you of Gideon, Barak, Samson, Jephthah, David, Samuel, and the prophets. Now, I don't know if any of those names are familiar to you or not, but listen, the first four of these are all judges. Come on now. I looked at that and I went, wow, I know those guys. I did a study of the book of Judges. I know these guys. They're all judges. Watch this. He puts four of them right there. There are four judges. Then look what he did. He puts David and then Samuel and the prophets. He broke the sequence. You do understand that. Because Samuel should be there, because Samuel was the last prophet, and then David. But he didn't. He broke the sequence. The question is, why? You do see he broke a sequence of judges. He went boom, 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 boom. And these are not in order. He just picked these four judges. That did make Hebrews 11. These are four that made it. Samuel made it as a judge and a prophet. When it says Samuel the prophet, it's because he started a school of biblical theology for the prophets. And two of his star students were Elijah and Elisha. These were the three, what were called the masters of the seminary. The headmasters. Well, yeah, it's just kind of interesting. Listen, by the end of this study, you should be able to answer the question I ask. Why is this out of order? Well, you want me to give it now? I am not going to do that. We're going to find the answer. Here are 4 points. First, the birth story of Samuel is the second most read in the Christian home and church, second only to the story of the birth of Jesus Christ. The reason I guess that's so famous is because we talk about it once every year. We don't have an annual thing in the church that would talk about the birth of Samuel, and yet it's highly known and read about Hannah and her prayer and this boy. It's the second most read. And what little child doesn't know the story of Hannah? And, I mean, so I find that very interesting. I find it interesting that it's interesting. And I'll tell you something. Over my many years of pastoring, I've met a lot of women who are barren. This is their favorite story. They know this story inside and out. Samuel was born into a priestly tribe of Levi. Now, in order for you to understand that, you've got to do a lot of research. You can't get it. Chapter 1 will tell you. In 1 Samuel 1:1, it tells you. But listen, you have to really be a reader and a researcher to put all that stuff together. So I'm going to help you. In verse 1, now there was a certain man, and this Ramathaim Zophim is going to be reduced. That's its official name, is going to be reduced the rest of the book to Ramah. It'll just say Ramah after this. From the hill country of Ephraim. And his name is Elkanah, and then it gives his genealogy, which is important to the research. You run genealogy when you come that way. Unless you're lazy, you run genealogy. Biblical historians believe that Elkanah was a Kohathite priestly singer of the tabernacle. They believe that because this is exactly what it says in 1 Chronicles 6:16. Through 22, 23, 26 through 28, 32 through 34, where his name is mentioned along with Samuel's. So you can do your own research. They were Levites who lived in Ephraim. Unger, in his Bible, right, page 310, writes about the Levites living in other tribal areas. Because they lived all over the place. Like pastors live all over the place to serve the Lord. And wherever they were, if you were in Ephraim, if you were a Levite and you were living in the under the tribe of Ephraim, then you had to obey the civil laws. Unger points this out. As far as his civil standings was concerned, he belonged to the tribe of Ephraim. The Levites being reckoned as belonging to those tribes in the midst of which they lived. Okay? Like if you moved to Alabama. Change your residency and all of that. And Unger is right. In fact, in the book of Judges, there's a very famous story in Judges, the 19th chapter. It's a famous story. Now, this is a story where a Levite's wife was raped and tortured, and nobody would do anything. He cut her up and cut her in 12 pieces and sent her to all the tribes of Israel and said, "What are we going to do about this?" I guess you've read that story, right? No, I bet you will now. It's gore. So, in this famous story, in Judges 19, in verse 1, it says this. In those days, Israel had no king. This is the period of the Judges. Now, a Levite who lived in a remote area in the hill country of Ephraim. See, that's just like my Samuel and his father, Elkanah. Right? That's where they live. Okay. I'm just showing you. This happens a lot. All right? Here's the second thing. Samuel was sent to a priestly boarding school of the high priest Eli as a toddler to the service of the tabernacle based on his family background of musicians of the tabernacle, especially singers. You've seen movies where these the Arab people and the Jewish people, how they sing. Not something like that. I was an Indian. Now, it's not quite like that, but you know. I went back to my old days of cowboys and Indians right there. This boarding school business, this teaches how important, now listen to me, this is so important you get this. This teaches how important the will of God is personally to the direction of a believer's life. Even when a child has godly parents. She sent him off to boarding school, and that's not what God is going to do with his life. Now, God knew this from eternity past. God would not have made that decision. You understand that? That's not what his, that wasn't in his heart to do at all. In fact, other than the worship atmosphere, he wasn't going to be part of the temple at all. Even though he was a Levite. God wasn't going to let him have anything to do with that. He was going to put him out there. His ministry was to the nation. So it's just interesting because Hannah thought that Samuel should follow his family into priestly service. I don't fault her for that. But she should have waited on the Lord. Because God had a different plan for Samuel's life. She'd have paid attention to it. I gave you verses that would be interesting to you. And listen, let me just speak to men for a moment. When she brought this up to Elkanah, the husband, who was a priest in service, he went wimpy on her. He went wimpy on her, spiritually wimpy. You know what he did? He said, in chapter 1, verse 20, he said to her, well, then do what you think is best. You know, what do you mean? You do what you think is best. You gave birth. Apparently this... What are you? Can I tell you that's bad parenting? Can I tell you that's bad husbanding? Can I tell you that Adam did it with Eve? And can I tell you Abraham did it with Sarah, with Hagar? What kind of foolishness is this? What kind of foolishness is this? What kind of foolishness? Says this. God answers prayer in his life, and he thinks he doesn't have any part of it other than sex. Right? What kind of foolishness is this? This is wimpy. This is not spirit. Listen, there's a way to do it. I'm not talking about an iron fist rule. I'm talking about being a spiritual man of God. This upsets me so bad. And how about her prayer? Everybody just gets all googly over. Listen, when she's praying to God, the Bible says that her heart was filled with anguish and grief because she was barren. What kind of foolishness is that? I mean, did she know that God opens and closes wombs? You think God's going to answer her because she's full of drama and melancholy and weeping and crying and moaning and groaning, that somehow God will give you what you want because you're whiny? He'll give it to you because it's the Word of God. You pray according to His will. You don't sit there and whine and beg and cry and grieve for what you don't have. You be rejoiceful and thanksgiving for what you do have. We Christians are just as dumb as they are. What kind of foolishness is this? This is terrible behavior with God. Okay, well, I feel better. Thank you. Because Hannah wanted the best spiritual priestly training for Samuel. She sent him away from home, godly parenting, and sibling bonding. As if that wasn't important to the development of this young man. I mean, God didn't even do that with Jesus. I think sometimes parents, you get really goofy when it comes to career orientation of your children. Nothing is more important than spiritual in their life. Because listen, all that stuff, if you don't connect them to God when they leave your home, is God, and they're under His rule and reign, and they're happy with that, they wind up with children that are a mess. An absolute mess. Oh, educated? Yeah. God, yeah. But spiritually, zero. Zero. Why do you do that? You listen to the world, that's why. You don't listen to the Word of God. You listen to the world. She listened to the world. They said, not listen to God. She didn't listen to God. In fact, she was so out of control that Eli thought she was tipping a few. Thought she'd come. Well, you've been to an Alabama football game? What's this up? What's wrong with you? Let me tell you. In this story, the sad part is not what is best for the child, nor for the home, nor for the marriage, nor for the family. None of that is discussed. What she thinks best for the child actually turns out wasn't. How crazy is that? She could have consulted God. God would have told her right off. Was spent too much crying and not enough listening to God. Spending way too much talking, not enough listening. I don't know. I'm destroying this little thing. I mean, how about Proverbs 22:6? How about training the child till he's grown, where he can do his own deal? How about that? When are you going to start training your child to put their hand in God? Put your hand in the hand. How's that go, Horton? Put your hand in the hand. The man from Galilee. There you go. I got my hand somewhere, but I got to get it out of your hand, don't I? Get it, man of Galilee. Proverbs 22:6, train up a child in the way to go. Listen, you train them all the way up until enough to go. You train them all the way up. You never turn them loose. Listen, when you know that child shouldn't be turned loose, you keep them home. You don't send them off to some kind of boring school. We call it college today. You send your daughter to college, becomes two times a child of hell with a degree. Keep him in town, send him over to Jeff State, and then send him down to UAB where you can keep a tab on him till he's good enough to go. Oh, I see. Oh, geez. I don't know why the Lord's picking on you, but He is. Must be somebody on the internet. Listen, your children need to be well grounded in 2 Timothy 3:15 and 16. They're not ready to go off anywhere. Where are they ready to go off to? They jump on a horse and ride it backwards. They don't know the difference between the front and the back. They need to really, you need to be comfortable. Your children are well established in 2 Corinthians. I'm not going to read it to you. Read it yourself. Your children ought to be established in 2 Timothy 3:15 and 16 before you push them out to the wolves. Be careful what you do with your children. Be careful what you do with them. When you go visit them unexpectedly, like my mother did, maybe you got the same gall that she had to jerk me up and tell me, listen, you want to go to college another way, you're coming back home. And you're going to work your way through college. Well, I don't know. Oh, I do. I do it. I do. Hit you with a frying pan. That's my mama. You will do it. I knew when she said she talked fine print business, I went, yeah, my mama would do it. My mother didn't have to. She didn't sit around and gab with me. She didn't make a second visit to college to see me either. When they told her there that she couldn't talk to anybody about my grades, my mother talked to somebody about my grades. I could have told him, give him up. But she had to go through three different levels. She wasn't going anywhere until she saw my grades. Is this a police department I'm in, or is this college? We talk about my money? That's my mama. I'm going, if I have to go to whoever is the top of this place, I'm going there, and I'm going to have my day. I went, oh, mother, I'm going back to the dorm. No, you're not. We're walking this thing out. Well, anyhow, godly parenting directs their children towards their heavenly Father. You be sure that their hand is in His hand, where they are now dependent on Him to get them through. Now your children have left home and your training's over because they know they've put their hand in the hand of the man of Galilee. Thank you. I can't tell you how difficult this is, too. Listen, I've gone through this. I've gone through with all mine. It's tough. Oh, they think they're ready long before they're ready. Oh, yeah, they're ready to get out and do it. Not on my watch. Not on my watch. Listen, your goal of godly parenting and grandparenting is to connect them with the Heavenly Father, not verbally, explicitly. And she sends Eli. Eli can train him but can't put his hand in the hand. He can't put his own kid's hand in the hand. So God has to do it. Throws him out there and God does it. Eli keeps him in a narrow window because he's in the service of the priesthood. He's in boarding school, so he directs him into boarding school. He didn't parent him at all. He was the headmaster. Wasn't a parent. His parents gave him away to a jerk called Eli. He's a jerk. Would have given my kids to him. I wouldn't have sent him to his church. Which is another story. The third thing. It is chapter 3 that God reveals His life, His will for the ministry of Samuel. And this is important. I don't know, probably most people, just a few of us, care about oddities of the Bible. Oddities. Oddities in the Bible was what drives me to want to write books. It's those things that are just kind of like, oh, wow. Samuel is one of eight people in the Bible where God audibly called their name. Hoo-yah! And hoo-yah went, yeah. No, I don't. There wasn't a hoo-yah. So I wrote these down. I didn't give you Bible verses because I want you to stop being lazy. But he did Abraham. He did Moses. He did Jacob. Beloved son and most famous one is Saul. Everybody knows about Saul. Saul, Saul, why dost thou persecute me? Right? Do you know that he audibly called Samuel four times? To be a prophet? Boy, that's staying after it, isn't it? I mean, the Heavenly Father called his name Samuel, something like that. I don't know.
Samuel!
I don't know. I know my little Evelyn. Angie can put him on the phone and I can go like, Evelyn, Evelyn. And she just goes nuts. I think she thinks the dog's after her or something. I don't know. But she just goes, and in the house, I can walk in the room and I can go like, Evelyn. And she just goes, she gets to going like nuts. If you'll give them candy when their mother isn't looking. That's the secret. You give them a little sugar and they go like, yeah, Evelyn. She go like, and nobody, they think the baby loves her grandpa, but she don't know grandpa. She just knows Sugar Man. Sugar Man. This is one of eight, and this is this enormous thing, and you always pay attention to these things like that because this is a big event. Listen, this is a big event. I mean, this is a big Samuel. I mean, one call from God ought to have been enough. Can you hold? I got to run and see. Well, he did that. He called the first time and he said, can you hold a minute? And he runs to get Eli. Right? And then he hangs up. Ben will call me. His mother don't know he has a phone. He can call me. And I know it's him. There's nobody talking. You know, the number comes up, and I know it's Angela's telephone. And there'll be this silence. And I go, okay, Ben, let's have it, Bubba. Dr. Grandpa, is your garbage can full? That's what I get. And then the second thing I get, and I go like, well, it's half full. Well, take it out. Yeah. And then he goes like, can I talk to Grandma? And I go, well, I guess that was over. It was just a call about the garbage. You get no respect, Frank. No respect. The Lord calls Samuel's name four times in 1 Samuel 3, verses 4 through 10. The Lord called Samuel to be a prophet to the nation of Israel, to be the last judge, and to be a prophet to a theocracy monarchy. He was the first, listen, I found this in here. This is another one of these oddities that I like. He was the first national prophet after Moses. Isn't that interesting? See, Moses was the guy who established the nation. He's the guy that formed the monarchy that's going to take us all. Listen, the monarchy is the big deal about Jesus Christ, isn't it? Everybody thought he was a king. The Magi come, the king. The people are going, the king. And he went, well, wait, I got to be the Savior first and, you know, the cross and then the crown. Just the phenomenalness of this in the Word of God is so important. We haven't had a guy like this since Moses. In Jeremiah 15:1, this idea is brought out. It says, then the Lord said to me, even though Moses and Samuel were to stand before me, my heart would not be with this people. Send them away from my presence and let them go. Woo-hoo-hoo. There's another national prophet that don't want to hear those words and go tell them. They'll bury him with his head up, right? That was good because they didn't bury him with his head down. That'd be a bad deal. Because one too good with your left, with your head above ground, and then rats. So here's one. 1 Samuel 3:20. All Israel from Dan to Beersheba knew that Samuel was confirmed as a prophet of the Lord. So I saw a principle here for Rod Edema. You don't have to toot your own ministry horn or engage in some advertising campaign to get a ministry. How about that? He didn't do nothing but go out and do what God called him to do. And God made everybody throughout the entire land know that he was the prophet of God sent for the nation. How good is that? Listen, if it is of God, he will make it known to others. Maybe if you have to toot your horn, you should consider the music ministry. Right? I'm not being facetious, but if you're going to toot a horn, then it sounds like that's music to me. Finally, we will examine, and I'm going to let you go home on this. This will be homework, home study, to examine 7 point of overview of what God had in mind for Samuel's ministry in the place. This is why, these 7 points, is why Samuel is listed after David. And he was such a good prophet that that's why his name is attached to two books, and he's a minor person in the two books. But he was a major player. Okay? So you all that on it. Be sure to read Psalms 99, verse 6. Samuel was among those who called his name. They called upon the Lord. And he's referring to Moses, Aaron, and Samuel. He referring to three guys, Moses, Aaron, and Samuel, when he says Psalms 99, 6. Well, let's close in a word of prayer. This is where we'll be going in the book of Samuel. Well, Father, we're thankful tonight for these have come our way to study with us, both by automobile and internet. We pray, Father, as they digest this information, that not only did they study it under the filling ministry of the Holy Spirit, but as they go back and digest it to take it from hearing to believing, through that process, they would still be that Spirit-filled person, so that it could be assimilated in their life through spiritual growth maturity, that they too one day could be in a ministerial role of spiritual maturity like Samuel. That's my prayer for me, to be that type of man that will carry the ball all the way to the goal line without looking back. And when I get there, not take credit for it. It was God's grace and faithfulness to me that carried me the way. It wasn't by my own strength or might. In Jesus' name we've prayed. Amen.